First John chapter 5, I want to talk a little bit about what we're talking about this morning, about the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, when you have someone as fascinating and wonderful as the Lord Jesus Christ is, just the marvelousness of who he is, to be loved by somebody that fantastic is just a humbling thing. And to have someone like that love you and appreciate you and value you and give himself for you. Paul says for the love of Christ constrains us, and I certainly understand what that is, because the more you appreciate him, the more you appreciate the constraining nature and power of his love for you. And it says the love of Christ constrains us. That's not your love for him, that's his love for you. And we love him because he first loved us. And involved in that, we're looking at this morning at 1 John 5, verse 7. This is the key verse in the Bible about the Trinity. And we call it the Trinity. The Bible calls it the Godhead. Colossians chapter 1, we looked at it this morning. Chapter 2, that in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Everything that is to be God, all that God is, who God is in the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the God-man. He's truly God. He's truly man. And both of those things are important for him to be our Savior. You don't want to leave one out and emphasize the other and make the other the only thing. I was raised in a denomination that now is a very modernistic denomination. And they've talked about the divinity of Christ. You got 1 John. Look at the book of Revelation just a second. Words have meaning. The book of the Revelation, you see the title, the revelation of John, of St. John the Divine. That doesn't mean that they think John was God. A divine, now in churchianity, they call preachers the divines. That's a spokesman for God. And when you hear about divinity, that's someone who is representing God. But they're not saying they're God. And when you hear about the divinity of Christ, that's somebody that's not talking about his deity. That's talking about somebody talking about, well, he represents God. In the Bible, Jesus, it isn't his divinity, it's his deity. He's the God-man. And in him dwelt all the fullness of who God is in bodily in our humanity. The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And it's those two things. The man, Christ Jesus, is the one who is the mediator between God and men. And so that makes him our Redeemer. But that brings you to the issue about the Godhead. Who's in the Godhead and what's the Godhead like? In 1 John chapter 5, verse 7, for there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father and the Word and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. Now that verse is left out, as I said this morning, of every new Bible. The Protestant Bibles that precede the King James Bible and the King James Bible have that verse in it. But in modern versions, they leave it out because they say, well, it's called the John in comma, and they don't think that the manuscript evidence is adequate to put it there and so forth. The passage is quoted in the 3rd and 4th century by church fathers. When you go through Grace School of the Bible and you study through manuscript evidence, one of the things that we teach in the first semester is that the way you reconstruct a text is not just the manuscripts. There are between 5,000 and 6,000 manuscripts and pieces of them, but there are other ways to reconstruct a text. One is what are called patristic quotations. That is the writings of the early church fathers. And when you had a church father in the 4th century that would write and quote this passage and write it and put it in a publication that he puts out to the public that and has this passage in it, the assumption is that everybody that he's writing through thinks it's part of the Bible because he's got it in. He wouldn't put it in his writing if they didn't think it's part of the Bible. And one of the ways that you reconstruct a text is that way. And this text is validated over and over and over again as authentic because of the other ways that you construct a text. Leaving it out leaves out the keystone. And by the way, the people that leave it out, where that comes from is a lot of folks, many of whom were Unitarians who did not believe in the Trinity. It enhanced their doctrinal position to take this verse out. But just when you look at the verse, there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. And these three are one. And there are three that bear record, that bear witness in the earth. Now what the new Bibles do is they take verse 7, for there are three that bear record, and from in heaven all the way down to verse 8 in earth, they take that out. And they make it read, for there are three that bear record, the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And they leave that intermediate thing out. Now, if you were reading the Greek text, you'd immediately see a problem. Because when he says in verse 7, there are three, that's masculine. And when you have a masculine, it needs to have masculine modifiers. But when you get down to Spirit, water, and blood, that's neuter. So just when you read the Greek text, you say there's something missing in there. And so we don't spend a lot of time worrying about that because we know what the Bible is. But that's part of the attack. But when it says the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one, that's the three members of the Godhead. And I said this morning, when you think about that, those three members of the Godhead, they all share in deity. They're all God. But they're three different people. And so we define the Trinity as one God, one in essence and being, one in their essence of who they are, and three in persons. And I've used an illustration I did this morning that makes sense to me. We sit here in this room, and we're all one in our humanity. Paul says it in Acts 17 that God made of one blood all nations to dwell upon the face of the earth. It doesn't make any difference who you are, what your ethnic derivation is now. We all come from Adam. We're one humanity, but we're also 7 billion in persons. We're equally human, and we're also equally individuals. Well, the Godhead is that way: one deity, one essence of God, Godness, and three. There are only three people that share that essence of deity, and they've done it forever because they're God. They're the creators. No, nothing was there before they were there. And the fascinating thing about the Godhead to me, one of the fascinating things is how they relate to one another. You have the Father. Ooh, we're securing our manhood. We used pink up there this morning. And Alex used pink for the numbers, so that's good. One of the brothers was telling me this, I shouldn't say this publicly, I guess, because you might be listening. But one of the brothers is going to paint, one of our men is a painter, and he's going to paint another brother's house, and he's going to paint it pink as a prank. When you have brothers and sisters in Christ, they like to prank you. Yeah, now you guys are all mature. You wouldn't do anything like that. But this one brother whose house is getting painted pranked this brother who is painting the house. So this is get back time. And when you paint the facade around somebody's house pink, I told him, said, it won't bother him. He's secure in his manhood. It won't bother him at all. That pink doesn't bother us. Anyway, that's got nothing to do. We can cut that out of the video. We won't put that in there. But you can, in 2 weeks, you'll know who all that is if you're around. You have the Father, then you have the Son, and then you have the Holy Ghost. So you have he's called the Word. The Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. And they're one. All of the essence, all that makes up deity, all that makes God God, they all share that. But they're three in persons. Now, the relationship that they have with one another is what I just want to talk with you a little bit about tonight. Because when the Bible says God is love, the way the Godhead functions among itself is that the Father values his Son above all things. Come with me, if you will, to, we looked at some of this morning. Come with me over to Colossians chapter number 1. Charity, love. Come with me to Romans 13 to start with, just to understand the thinking of the Godhead. Romans chapter 13, verse number 8. Owe no man anything but to love one another. For he that loveth another hath fulfilled the law. To fulfill God's requirements is the essence of what love is about. Look with me at Galatians chapter number 5. Galatians 5, verse number 13. For brethren, you have been called into liberty. Only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. So if you love your neighbor as yourself, if you serve one another out of love, out of value and esteem for them, and you serve them, you're living the way God designed his creation to live. So the way the members of the Godhead live is each one of the members of the Godhead loves, values, and esteems the other members of the Godhead. And the desire to live in service for the others. No member of the Godhead lives to serve himself or to be served by the other members. They all live to serve one another. Colossians chapter 1, verse 19. We looked at this passage this morning. Pull a page out of my Bible. Colossians 1, 19. For it pleased the Father that in him, that is in Christ, should all fullness dwell. And the fullness has to do with the end of verse number 18, that in all things he, that is Christ, might have preeminence. God the Father created all things, verse number 16, for by him, that is Christ, were all things created that are in heaven, that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether it be thrones, dominions, principalities, or powers, all things were created by him and for him. Notice when the Father gave instructions to create all things, he did it Christ goes and creates it, and he creates it by him, and he creates it for him, but he doesn't create it for himself. He creates it because that's the Father's will, and the Father's will in the creation is so that his Son would have a place to have preeminence in all of that. The Father's will in creation was that his Son would be exalted as the head of all things because it pleased the Father. The Father's pleasure is for his Son to be exalted. Now you recall Matthew chapter 3. Come back to John chapter 3. When he says, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. The Father's pleasure dwells in his Son. In John chapter 3, verse number 34. John 3:34. For he whom God hath sent speaketh the words of God. For God giveth not the Spirit by measure unto him. Let's talk about Christ. For the Father loveth the Son, and hath given all things unto his hand. The Father loves the Son, and everything focuses in him. If you come over to chapter 5, verse number 5:22. For the Father judgeth no man, but hath committed all judgment unto the Son, that all men should honor the Son, even as they honor the Father. He that honoreth not the Son honoreth not the Father, which hath sent him. So the Father sees his Son, and he wants his Son to be honored above all things. So God the Father lives, and in his relationship, he honors his Son. He seeks to honor and serve and love his Son. He does the same thing with the Holy Spirit. Come with me, if you will, to 2 Peter chapter number 1. In the Father's relationship to the Spirit, he seeks to honor the Spirit. He seeks to value and esteem the Holy Spirit, just as he values and esteems the Son. Get 2 Peter chapter 1 and Psalm chapter 138. 2 Peter 1. In Psalm chapter 138. 2 Peter 1, Psalm 138. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse number 21. 2 Peter 1, 21. For prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were what? Moved by the Holy Spirit. So how did the Word of God come about? God the Holy Spirit, all Scripture given inspiration of God. God the Holy Spirit moves the writers, and the Word of God is the work product of God the Holy Spirit. Now in Psalm 138, look at God the Father's attitude about the work product of the Spirit. Psalm 138, verse number 2. I will worship toward thy holy mountain, and praise thy name for thy loving kindness and for thy truth. For thou hast magnified thy word above thy name. So what God the Father does is he says, here's the work product of God the Holy Spirit. God the Holy Spirit writes the word of God. And the Father's attitude about what the Holy Spirit does is the Father exalts it above his own name. He puts it above himself. The Father loves the Son. He loves the Holy Spirit. He honors the Son. He honors the Holy Spirit. And the Father's attitude toward the other members of the Godhead is, I value and esteem you, and I work to honor you and esteem you above myself. That's what charity is in 1 Corinthians 13. Esteem others better than yourself. And so the Father does that. Now, the same is true of God the Son. When you see God the Son's attitude toward the Father, his attitude toward God the Father is, lo, I come to do, and a volume of a book is written to me, I come to do thy will, O God. I'm going to do what you want done. I'm going to honor you. We read the passage in Philippians chapter 2 this morning, that when you confess the Lord Jesus Christ as Lord, who are you glorifying? You're not glorifying him, you're glorifying the Father. You're glorifying what the Father's done. So the Father is the one who Christ honors in all things. John chapter 17. See, we'll get John chapter 5. We looked at John 17 this morning. John 17, verse number 1. These words spake Jesus and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour is come, glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee. He's not asking him to glorify him so he can be glorified. He understands that you glorify me with the glory I had with you before the world began. Verse 5. Now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. Why? So that I then can glorify you, glorify him. The issue that Christ has is to be able to glorify his Father in all things. If you come back to chapter 5, verse number 19. Then answered Jesus and said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself. Now think about that. Could he forgive sins? Yes, he did. Could he calm the sea? Yes, he did. We looked at the verses this morning. That's what Jehovah does. He had these attributes of deity to do deity things. Do what Jehovah, he's Jehovah. He says in John 10, he says, no man takes my life. I lay it down. I take it up again. So he can do the things, so what does he mean? The Son of Man can do nothing. It's of himself. I'm not doing any of those things independently on my own. I'm doing them because they are the will of my Father. But what he seeth the Father do, for whatsoever things he doeth, these also doeth the Son. In other words, when Christ said, when I'm here as man on the earth, I'm here as the servant of my Father. I'm honoring his word. I'm honoring his will. I'm not independently doing it for me. I'm doing these things because they glorify my Father. Verse 30, I can't of mine own self do nothing. Now, he could do it in his deity. He's not saying that. He said, I don't do it independently of my Father's will. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just, because I seek not my own will, but the will of the Father which has sent me. He's subjected himself, humbled himself, and become obedient, willingly choosing to be obedient to his Father's will. He loves his Father. He wants to honor and exalt his Father. So the Son, in everything he does, is to glorify the Father. His attitude toward the Holy Spirit is the same way. If you come with me over to Luke chapter number 4. Luke chapter 4. verse number 18. I can get to Luke 4. Christ is in the synagogue at Nazareth, and he's going to quote Isaiah chapter 61. Finds a place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, the recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord." And he closed the book, and when he had given it to the minister and sat down, the eyes of them which were in the synagogue were fastened on him, and he began to say unto them, "This day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears." Now we know that there's a dispensational thing going there, because he quotes Isaiah 61 verse 1 and only the first part of verse number 2, and he stops at the comma in verse number 19. He stops in the middle of Isaiah 61 verse 2 to preach the acceptable year of the Lord, comma, and the day of vengeance. He doesn't say that, because that's the second coming. But the first part of verse 1 and verse 2, first part of verse 2 in Isaiah 61 is about the first coming of Christ. And you see what he says? "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me. He's the one that's empowering me. He's the one that's giving me the capacity to do. I'm depending on the will of the Father and the power and the working of the Spirit of God in me." Now go back to John chapter 5 and think again about that verse we read. I'm sorry, John 3. John 3, verse 35. Or verse 34. "For whom God hath sent, for he whom God hath sent speaketh the words of God, for God giveth not the Spirit by measure unto him." The Father gave the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, without any reservation. The power of the Spirit of God worked in the Lord Jesus Christ. He was using, in obedience to the Father, the power and working of the Holy Spirit. He's depending on the Holy Spirit. "The Father loveth the Son and hath given all things in his hands." So the Lord Jesus Christ, he doesn't go around and say, "The Spirit of God did it through me, but it's me." He gives credit where it belongs. He points to the working of the Holy Spirit in his life and says, "That's where the power to do what I'm doing comes from. That's where it comes from, the Spirit of God working in me." Look with me at John chapter 14. When he predicts the coming of the Holy Spirit in the new covenant in Acts chapter 2 and Pentecost. John 14. Verse number 12. "Verily I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go to my Father, and whatsoever you shall ask in my name will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. If you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, for he dwelleth with you, and shall be in you, and I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you yet a little while, and the world seeth me no more, but ye shall see me, because I live, and ye shall live also." The Spirit of God's going to come, take his place. In verse 12, he says, when he comes, he will do greater works. His working in you is going to be greater than my work. He doesn't put the Holy Spirit down. He exalts the Holy Spirit, what the Spirit of God's going to accomplish. Through what they're going to accomplish through the power and presence of God, the Holy Spirit. So my point to you is that each of the members of the Godhead loves one another, works to exalt one another, works to esteem other better than themselves. Now, if you think about that, come with me to Ephesians chapter number 1. You know, you think about faith, hope, and charity. So they have charity, they value and esteem one another. Ephesians chapter 1, when they talk about the future. Hope is that confident expectation of sure things to come. Ephesians chapter 1, verse number 9, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, that's the Father's will. Verse number 3, blessed be God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He talks about the Father down through this passage. Having made known unto us the mystery of his, the Father's will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of time, he might gather together in one all things, where? In Christ. So what's the Father's plan for the future? That everything would be placed under the headship of his Son. The Father's plan for the future is to exalt his Son above all things, both which are in heaven, which are in the earth, even in him. So the Father's plan is to exalt his Son above all things, whether it's in the heavens or whether it's in the earth. That's what God the Father is going for. He calls it the mystery of his will. If you look over at Titus, hold your hand here and come to Titus chapter number 1. Titus chapter 1, verse number 2. In hope of eternal life. Here's the hope that that eternal life gives you. Which God, that cannot lie, promised before the world began. Well, that's Ephesians 1, 9. Having made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself, back before the world began. But now, verse 3, but hath in due times revealed his word, through preaching, which is committed unto me, according to the commandment of God our Savior. That plan that he had before the foundation of the world, there's a part of it he never told anybody about. Now you understand, in Acts 3, Peter talks about prophecy, what God did talk about. Peter in Acts 3 tells Israel that he's talking about the second coming of Christ. Acts 3:21. You better just look over there at it, because I looked at Don, it scared me. Verse went right out of my head. That's a pretty good thing, Don, shake this verse out of my head. Acts 3:21, or Acts 3:20. I'll go back to Acts 3:18. But those things which God before has showed into the mouth of all his prophets, that Christ should suffer, he has so fulfilled. Everything in prophecy about the sufferings of Christ, he fulfilled. On the cross, John 19, one of those verses that just sticks in my mind all the time. He's there and he says, in order that this verse might be fulfilled, he said, I thirst. Everything in his mind, he's going through the verses. Christ is on the cross. His mind's thinking about that verse, that's been fulfilled, that verse, that. There's one verse over there in Psalm 69 that hadn't been fulfilled yet. So he says, I thirst, so that they give him the drink, Psalm 69 says they'll give him. He's ticking them off one by one by one by one. And Peter says, everything that was prophesied about the sufferings of Christ have been fulfilled. Repent ye therefore and be converted, because the next thing that's coming is God's wrath, the day of his wrath. And look, if God has fulfilled everything minutely up to that point, don't worry. The stuff he's predicted about the wrath, it'll come too. Now that's the point he's making. But look how he does it. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing should come from the presence of the Lord, and he shall send Jesus, which before was preached unto you, whom the heaven must receive until the times of restitution of all things. Now watch. Which God has spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the world began. From Genesis chapter 1 all the way to this point, God has been revealing a plan and a purpose to restore his authority in the earth through the instrumentality of a kingdom that's been vested in the nation of Israel with Christ as its head. That's what prophecy in the Bible is all about. But this thing over here in Titus is something different than that. He says, not only does he have this prophesied, revealed, talked about, and spoken about purpose, he had a purpose also to restore his authority in the government of the heavenly places that he never told anybody about until he revealed it. Verse 3, Titus 1, 3, but hath in due times manifested his word through preaching, which is committed unto me according to the commandment of the everlasting God. Commandment of God our Savior. That's what Paul calls the mystery of the Father's will. And that secret purpose that the Father had, it's all centered in his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. It's all centered in what he's going to accomplish through his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the Father's plan to give him preeminence in all things. That's why Ephesians 1:10 says he's going to gather together all things in Christ. That's the Father's goal in all of his purpose and plan in creation. But if you go back to Ephesians, the Lord Jesus Christ understands that and buys into the plan. Verse number 7, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. So the Lord Jesus Christ understands the Father's plan, and he understands the necessity of redeeming man, and he willfully joins into the plan. There's a verse in 1 Peter chapter 1. Verse 20. 1 Peter 1, verse 18. For as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things, such as silver and gold, from your vain conversation received by tradition of your fathers. Pete says, you guys are not redeemed from all of that religious stuff under the Mosaic covenant by what you did, but with the precious blood of Christ. The only thing that will set you free from religious bondage is the blood of Christ. Even the religion that God only gave one religion in all of human history, gave to the nation Israel through the hand of Moses, and they corrupted it and made bondage out of it. And he says, you're redeemed from all of that by the precious blood of Christ, as a lamb without blemish and without spot, now watch, who verily was foreordained before the world began, but was manifest in these last times. Back there before the world began, in an eternal life conference that God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit had, God the Father came up with a plan. He said, this is what I want to do. God the Son says, I'll work to redeem it. God the Holy Spirit says, I'll go and apply it. As an old preacher used to say, the Father was the brains, the Son is the showboat, and the Holy Spirit is the workhorse. And that's sort of, you know, that's a kind of a crude way of saying it. But that's how the Godhead, each one works with the mindset of the other in view. When Christ is on the cross, Hebrews 12, verse number 2. You think, what was he thinking while he was there? Hebrews 12, 2, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and he sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. He understood what was being accomplished by what he did, and for the joy of what the Father had planned out there, he looked at this and said, it's nothing. Despise the shame. Didn't think of it as any real. And you think about what he went through, and you think, wow, that's something. Go back to Ephesians, chapter number 1. What does the Holy Spirit do with all this? Ephesians 1, verse 13. And whom you also trusted, talking about Christ, verse 12, that you would be to the praise of his glory who first trusted in Christ, in whom ye also trusted, after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Notice how this works out. There's a lot of discussion in theology and Calvinism and so forth about the order of salvation. What has to happen first, what has to happen second. Here's God's order, what God says. In whom ye also trusted. You trust Christ. That's how you get saved. After you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, nobody's going to trust Christ until you first hear the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. in whom also after that you believed. Now, this is not 5 years after you believed. This is just the order. First, you hear the gospel, and then you trust. You believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. You trust him to be the Savior. He died and rose again for you to be. And when you do that, then God the Holy Spirit does something. After you believed, you were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. So when you trust Jesus Christ as your Savior, God the Holy Spirit comes and he actually does five special things the moment you trust Christ. We put the word, we use the word cribs, C-R-I-B-S, to describe them. C is for he circumcises you, Colossians 2, verse 11 and 12. You're circumcised with that circumcision, putting off of the body the sins of the flesh. There's a literal separation from you, from your old identity into a new identity in Christ. You're regenerated. You're given his life. Your dead spirit has the live spirit of God, the spirit of life placed in you. Some people talk about being born again. That's your spirit is born of God's spirit. You're indwelt by God the Holy Spirit. He comes and makes your body his residence. And when the Bible talks about dwelling, it's not just talking about living there. Don's here visiting his family from, he's in Kentucky now. It's an upgrade from being in Wisconsin, but he's visiting his family in Wisconsin, and he's not dwelling in Wisconsin. He dwells in Kentucky. He's visiting in Wisconsin. God the Holy Spirit doesn't come to visit. He comes to dwell, to settle down and be at home in your life. That's why he's there. Now, you may not let him do that, but that's why he's there. C-R-I-B. He baptizes you. By one Spirit are we all baptized into the body of Christ. God has completely, radically changed you from being an Adam into a new creature in Christ Jesus. You're not who you used to be. You're somebody brand new. And then S, he seals you. He takes all of that and seals you. But you notice it says you're sealed not by the Holy Spirit, but with the Holy Spirit. His presence is the guarantee of your salvation, your redemption, your security. You see, he's the Holy Spirit. You're sealed with, you're sealed by the Father with the Spirit, which is the earnest of our inheritance unto the redemption of the purchased possession. You know what an earnest is? It's earnest. You say, I'm going to buy something. We rode up to Genoa City the other day to buy my grandson some fireworks to shoot off for 4th of July. You can't buy them in Illinois. You go across the, you go 10 feet across the border and there's firework place after firework place to get all the Illinois people's money. And we're up there and we go and we purchase the fireworks. There were place after place up there. The further you go up there, that's where all the boats are, all the lakes and stuff. And there was this boat sitting out on the road and it said $3,500. Now, this is a $40,000 boat, and I fell a-lusting, and I'm looking at that boat, and I'm thinking, $3,500, man, that really, I could find $3,500 faster than I'd find something to pull that boat home with, but I'm thinking about it, and so I looked it up on the internet. That was the down payment. That's not what the sign said. For sale, $3,500. But that's, I said, now I wouldn't buy it from you because you're a crook. Yeah. But that $3,500 is earnest money. The $40,000 that they wanted for the boat, $44,000 that they wanted for the boat, that $3,500, you give them that, that's the down payment. That's part of the sale price, but it's the guarantee that the rest is coming. So the Holy Spirit's the earnest of your, he's the down payment that your inheritance is coming. If you look at chapter 4, verse number 30, when Paul's talking about your conduct, he says in verse number 30, and grieve not the Holy Spirit of God. Did you know the only member of the Godhead you can abuse is the Holy Spirit? Whereby you're sealed until you sin against him and make him mad. Is that what it said? No. Whereby you're sealed unto the day of the redemption of the purchased possession. We call that the rapture. That's when the Lord comes and takes us out and completes our salvation, Salvation starts with justification, time past. It continues with our sanctification and growth in the present, and then it's completed when we are glorified with him at the resurrection. And it's the Holy Spirit that lives in you now that guarantees, he's guaranteeing what the Father planned, what the Son purchased. That's what he's guaranteeing. He's not working independent of the Father or the Son in your life. He's working to accomplish what God the Father planned and what God the Son purchased. All the members of the Godhead work for one another. Come back with me, if you will, to Romans chapter 3. Just one last passage. God the Father believes in God the Son. He trusts his Son. He trusted his Son enough to give him the job of being our Redeemer. At any point, Christ could have said, I don't want to do this. You remember Matthew 27? We have a song. We don't have it in this songbook, but he could have called 10,000 angels. Remember that? You remember where that comes from, Matthew 27? Jesus tells his disciples, don't you remember? Don't you know that I could just say the word and the Father would send legions of angels and this would all be over with? But the Father trusted his Son to accomplish his will. The Son trusted the Father. He goes down into the jaws of death and he trusted the Father to give him the command to rise. And he was raised again by the glory of the Father. He was the Spirit of God that quickened Jesus from the dead, but he also raised himself. But he didn't do it on his own. He did it because it was the command. This commandment have I received of my Father. Look, hold on to Romans 3 and look at John 10. It's such an exhausting. It's such a marvelous thing to watch the Father and the Son and the Spirit love each other, trust each other, give themselves in service to one another, trusting the will of the Father, trusting the work of the Son, trusting the work, each one trusting the other member of the Godhead with the whole ball of wax. John chapter 10. Verse 17, therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life, that I might take it again. No man taketh it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have the power to lay it down. I have power to take it again. Now watch, this commandment have I received of my Father. I can do it either way, but I'm doing it not because I want to do it, I'm doing it because it's my Father's plan. Paul calls that the faith of Christ. Look back with me at Romans chapter 3. Verse 21. But now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. Even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, not in him, but of him. Not your faith in him, but his faith, fullness, his worthiness for you to trust. The righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe. For there's no difference. There's your faith. There's your believing. So it's unto all and upon all them that believe. By the way, that's how you know how salvation works, how redemption works. It's for everybody. 1 Timothy says he's the Savior of all men, especially those that believe. Well, how can he be the Savior of all men and especially those that believe? There's some people say, well, everybody gets saved in the end. And you say, well, how do people get saved if they don't believe? Well, the way they teach it generally is that they die and go to hell, the lake of fire, and they're purged of their sins there. And you say, well, wait a minute. That's the Catholic doctrine of purgatory. And I thought we're purged by his blood, not by the fires of hell. And that's them. They pray for their own sins and they get out. You know, it's when people get to that point in universalism, it gets really kind of fuzzy.
Yeah.
And the crosswork gets left out. But this verse is pretty clear. It's unto all. It's available for everybody. Because Christ died for all men. But it's upon, put to the account of them that believe. The faithfulness of Jesus Christ accomplishes that. His faith and trust in his Father's will. Now come with me down to verse 35. Well, verse 23. For all that have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace, through the redemption that's in Christ Jesus. Where is grace found? It's found in the redemption that's in Christ Jesus. It's unto all and it's upon all them that believe. Whom God hath set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness, remission of sins that are passed through the forbearance of God, to declare us at this time his righteousness, that he might be the just and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. Now look at verse 25. Whom God, that's the Father, has set forth, God the Father sets forth his Son, to be a propitiation, a fully satisfying payment through faith in his blood. Who's having faith in the blood of Christ that the blood of Christ can pay for all sin? Well, who set him forth to do that? The Father did. God the Father has faith that the blood of his Son settles the sin issue. And it's a fully satisfying payment for sin, whereby he can be just, everything's paid for, everything's made right, and the justifier declare you righteous when you trust him. God the Father trusts his Son with the eternal destiny of his plan. Every member of the Godhead trusts each other. And they trust each other completely and fully. And God the Holy Spirit trusts that transaction right there enough to come and be the earnest of the inheritance that that purchases. I'm just saying to you, each member of the Godhead, how does God live? He lives in love and service. He doesn't live in self-esteem. He lives by love to serve the other members of the Godhead. They never live for themselves. So when we have the life of Christ living in us, what would that life look like? It would be a life that served others by that love that God has placed in our hearts through his Son. And Paul says, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. That's the life of Christ living in you. And Paul says, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. That's the life. That's the attitude of grace. That's the truth about what you do. When he says, when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, he's our life. That's the life that we live. We live his life. That's how he lives. He lives by love to serve one another. And every member of the Godhead, life in the Godhead, is the life of serving one another, esteeming other better than yourself. So when God put that life in his creation, that was the life he made for his creation to live in. And that's the life, when it lives, it reflects his will, his glory, and his purpose. Okay? Again, to be loved by God, that wonderful, who only lives. Listen, he didn't need to create you and me. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit had a complete, satisfying, loving life together. You think, why in the world would he have created things? He wanted to share the value and esteem he had for his Son with others. That's why I say to you, I'm fully persuaded that God the Father believes if you can see in his Son the joy, the glory, the wonderfulness that he sees in his Son, you would love him the way he does. And if you were to love him the way he does, you could not help yourself but to serve him as fully and freely as the Son does the Father. Anyway, it's wonderful to have a God like that. When you compare the gods of the world, the gods of religion, even Christendom, there's nothing like that. So I said this morning, go home and luxuriate. I had to spend the afternoon here working. I didn't get to go home and luxuriate yet, but I'm going to do that in a little while. But, you know, you just ought to sometimes just sit down and relax. You look at yourself and you see how you struggle with life and you see others struggling. And you try to come up with formulas to answer and things to do. When you can just relax and say, oh, how he loves you and me. And oh, how he loves me. Let that be the thing that just throws your heart. And the love of, Paul said, for the love of Christ constrains us because we thus judge. This is how we think. That if one died for all, then all were dead. And that he died for all so that they which live might henceforth live not unto themselves, but unto him that loved them and gave himself for them. Might live like God lives. Father, we thank you tonight for your love and your grace, for the privilege that you give us to be loved by you. And once again, we just say from the depths of our soul that we love you because you first loved us. And we pray that our lives might honor that love for the glory of our Savior, in Christ's name. Amen. All right, praise the Lord.